giving this keynote address. He's going to be speaking to us about microeconometric evidence on the role of human capital in the growth process. Mark is, for those of you who don't know, Frank Altschul, Professor of International Economics. He's also the Director of Economic Growth Center at Yale University. His research interests include causes and consequences of economic development and international migration. Mark, we are running 15 minutes late, so as agreed, we hope that we will not take more than 45 to 40 to 50 minutes back, and so that would leave us at least 10 to 15 minutes for discussion. Thank you. Mark, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you for the overview. The International Growth Center, not surprisingly, is interested in research that's relevant to growth. So the basic question is, how relevant is the research to growth that we all should be asking ourselves? And I'm asked to assess in the area of education and health what we might think about in terms of what's relevant and what's not relevant in that area. So I apologize in advance that, you know, that there's always this, my fear that this is going to be pompous. I'm going to skip over the first part of what's not relevant, which I may come back to, but start with growth theory, right? It's a good framework to think about growth as to what growth theory might tell us about where education and health may play a role. I'll go over this part fast just to summarize. So we start with exogenous growth models, where the growth rate's driven by technical change, purely. And we can think, Nelson and Phelps has a famous article where they talk about how low-income countries can catch up to high-income countries by the adoption of technologies from high-income countries. And we might think that education could play a role in facilitating that technological adoption. So we get that there. But then the question would be, why should education be helpful in that process? We have endogenous growth models. There are sort of two famous ones that we can look at. The first is associated with Romer. And the central point of his model is that there is learning by doing going on, and there are important learning externalities which give rise to a sustained growth rate. The idea is that there's ideas that are flowing. The new ideas are going to be embodied in new capital stocks. So new knowledge is embodied in new investments. And the spillovers occur because other firms can learn from the firms that made investments in these new technologies. So there's learning from others, and there's learning going on. It's key to this kind of model. So a natural question to ask is, does schooling have a role in facilitating this learning? And to what extent is there social learning in an economy? Lucas's point is that there are non-diminishing returns to human capital. Additions to human capital are higher or greater. The higher the level of human capital. So the relationship between the flow of human capital investments and the stock of human capital. And that can give rise to sustained growth rates that are actually fundamentally determined by the degree to which the stock of capital reproduces itself in terms of investments in human capital. And so we'd like to know, is this true with respect to, say, schooling? It presumes, of course, that human capital is actually productive in the economy, so we'd like to know how we would tell that. There's an issue about the role of schooling in the production of schooling. Now, notice that there's no direct role for health in fostering steady state growth rates in any of these models that anyone has drawn attention to that I know of. And most of the studies of health, and I'll talk about this in more detail, are really looking at the effects of health interventions on the level of income, not on growth rates, right? What's the connection? And I'm going to talk about that, the fact there can be a role of health in the production of learning and the production of skill eventually. All right, so the first thing we want to do is to look at what there is in terms of microeconometric evidence on simply learning. What is the connection between learning and schooling? Since learning plays a fundamental role in at least one of the growth models, really in both of them. Okay? So I'm going to use the little model that Andrew Foster and I worked with, which is the target input model, because it basically summarizes a lot of the things that we need to think about in terms of learning and schooling. And then I'll show you some results from with a table that's one of my favorite empirical tables. In the history of what I've done. Okay,
Okay, so the target input model is basically the idea is that, that profits are going to be a function of a new technology which has a best use probability there of eta. But the problem is you don't know how to use the technology very well. There's an input that's required. We had a little discussion of the Green Revolution earlier. I'm going to talk specifically about the Indian Green Revolution here. So you can think of the other input associated with the technology, say, as fertilizer, and the new technology is new seeds. And you get a hit. You don't do as well if you miss the target. That there's the target is a sort of moving, stochastically moving target of the amount of fertilizer you should use or the optimal input that you should use, and you're making a guess as to what that input is, right? And profits are going to depend on that. There's a loss. Farmers have priors over what the mean of the optimal input use is, and if you impose the structure, because it gives you some nice results, that the distribution of function for the optimal input is normal, and the priors that the farmers have, say in this case, are also distributed normally with a posterior variance, etc., then you get a very nice equation which says that expected profits are going to be a function of the best return minus the variance of the posterior and the variance of this stochastic input that's optimal. This, you can then build in Bayesian learning, and Bayesian learning says that the precision of your prior, the noise, the amount that you don't know, diminishes over time as a function of the number of times that you have worked with this new technology, right? It's very, very simple and very nice. So NJT is the prior experience with the new technology, and you can see that the variance in what you know, your posterior variance, is going to be an inverse function of N. And the effects of N have depend on the magnitude of the noise in the system. Okay, so the implications are straightforward. Profits in any period are going to depend on cumulative experience. Profits are thus going to rise over time, but they're going to rise with a diminishing rate. So these are all nicely testable. And the returns to learning is going to be positively related to the scale of the technology or its efficacy. So if you have a larger scale operation, the returns to getting this right are going to be bigger than if you have a smaller operation, right? That it's pretty straightforward. Okay. Now, we can build in schooling into this, at least hypothetically. We can say that schooling might affect the two types of precision. One, schooling might affect the precision of your prior about this new technology. So we can think of that more schools have access to information at the start of the new technology flowing in, right? And the second is that schooling facilitates learning. That is, those people who are learning by doing, learning from experience, maybe from others as well, I'll get to that, are doing that faster the more schooling they have. Those are the two roles that we can think of in this little model for doing that. And so you can look at the relationship between what you should expect is the profit trajectory and the amount of schooling that embeds all of the features of the technology of the model and the learning function. And the cross partial, which is how much schooling contributes to profits as a function of experience, is given by the second expression. And you get a very simple result, which is if there's no learning, then the effects of schooling diminish over time. That is to say, the only thing that schooling is doing is giving you this advantage at the start, then that advantage will diminish over time. There's no learning advantage in schooling. There's still learning, right? But the schooling is not making you a better learner. Then the learning by doing is going to trump the initial advantage, and the schooling effect will disappear over time, dissipate over time. On the other hand, if the advantage is relatively small, let's suppose zero, the initial advantage, then if high-capacity learners are more educated, you're going to find that the effect of experience on profits is going to be higher for the more educated, right? Pretty straightforward to do that, okay? So now I'm going to look at the literature. You know, what does the literature tell us about the extent to which there's actually learning that's credible? To what extent is education playing a role in this? And we can do that and sort of order the information in order, in increasing level of difficulty, okay? So first there's a set of studies that basically show there's no effect on anything anybody does or on productivity of schooling in a context where there's nothing going on, there's no new technology. Right? They don't emphasize it, but I'm going to show you the studies, that you can order the studies this way. Secondly, there are studies that show that the more schooled persons, respondents, use more of the new technology or adopt it first. Okay? But it's going to depend on what that technology is. Right? The model is emphasizing that you have to learn something for schooling to play an important role in this process. Okay? So we'll see what we can get from literature on that. Then we'd like to see if the more schooled actually have higher returns from the new technology, of course, acknowledging that whether they're using it or not is itself a choice variable. Okay? And we would like to see that those returns are higher for those technologies where it's plausible that there's something to learn. Okay? We want to establish that learning is taking place, and the best way to do that is to see what happens to actual productivity. Not through tests, but you know, that their profits rise over time as they learn, and what role schooling does that. Okay? And then the last thing, with, you know, which will clinch it, is that schooling actually does contribute to faster learning. Okay? So let's look at what that literature is. Right? So first, which is, there are no benefits to schooling in contexts in which there is nothing going on. So if you look at the DeFlo et al., the recent article in the 8-Yard, an experiment where they give thimbles of fertilizer to farmers to see what happened, if you read the details of this, there is zero effect of schooling on profitability in this context. And everyone agrees this is a context where they're using a traditional technology, everyone knows it, there's really no scope for learning. So that's a positive for the idea that schooling contributes to learning by the fact that there is no schooling effect in here. One of my favorite graphs is the following. So we have the productivity of Filipino sugar harvest workers, right? And they have piece rates, and we can collect their piece rates, and we can look at the relationship between two variables. These are the partial effects, the amount of schooling these harvesters have, and their height, okay? And you can see, not a surprise, right? But I will say that most work doesn't take this into account. Years of schooling has absolutely nothing to do with the productivity of these harvest workers, but their height does, right? Not a surprise, okay? So investment in schooling, if the world were harvest workers doing this kind of manual labor, the return to schooling would be essentially zero. There's no, what possible contribution could schooling make? So that's one other example. Then there's one other example. This is an article that I published with Paul Schultz, which was looking at another technological revolution. So obviously the harvest workers, they don't have a new technology, but there was, just like the Green Revolution in India, there was the contraceptive revolution, which had a date that you could find, right, 1965. Now they've released these new contraceptive technologies, pill and IUD. Back then, there were the demographic surveys done about use, et cetera. And we can look at who adopted these technologies first, and who used them more efficaciously. These were very detailed demographic surveys of complete contraceptive histories and birth rates and everything else. Now, what was this technology in the terms of what we're interested in here? So the new technology actually made birth control simpler compared to what birth control was before, say, the rhythm method, which is hard to figure out, right? So this is a new technology, but it's one that actually doesn't require any learning at all. Okay? And this is what we found. So in terms of just asking, this is not a survey we ran, but in the survey, women were asked, you know, do you know how to use these technologies? And the three technologies, pill, IUD, those are the new ones. This is in 1968, these were just out, and the traditional method. And you can see for the new method, there's no statistically significant difference between high school graduates and college graduates in terms of them saying, you know, yeah, I know how to do it. But the more educated actually were more literate about the old technology compared to the new technology. The nice thing about this survey, because you may not believe these statements, is you can actually estimate the actual use efficiency of these techniques to actually see how well they were using them. And here we go. So this is the effectiveness, efficacy of actual use of these new technologies on the left, comparing the high school and college graduates, and you see there's zero difference between high school and college graduates with this brand new technology But the difference in the old technology, which is the one that's quite difficult to figure out, biological rhythms and all that sort of thing, a massive difference. So it's not necessarily true that all, when there's new technologies, that there's something to learn or education's gonna have a payoff. It's gonna depend. All right, so there's, though, a central event that we can learn a lot from is the Indian Green Revolution. Okay? Here's an example of new technologies that weren't obvious how to use, weren't obvious where they would be most efficient at all. So everyone, I'm sure, knows the story. The high-yielding varieties were invented outside of India. But India was, Indian policy here was just superb. It was really sophisticated. One, it was open to bringing in these, this is an aside, but was open to bringing in these technologies, even though they were foreign, and even though, you know, who knows what they actually would have done to indigenous varieties. No fear of that. They had some sense of where these seeds would be most productive. They actually picked winners in terms of locations to make sure that fertilizer was available and subsidized. Everyone knows this story. So it's market openness. But the characteristics of this new technology are important because these seeds were much more sensitive to water and to fertilizer. Right? And these farmers had never used them before. And this graph is the experimental results from using the new varieties from a UP agricultural extension station for yields by fertilizer. Okay, so this shows what was said earlier when there was a discussion of the Indian Green Revolution. So the top three graphs there with the Spanish names, because they were invented in Mexico, right? This is on Indian soil now. You can see the yields are much higher than the UP traditional varieties that you can see there. And you can see that they're much more sensitive to fertilizer as well, right? So you can get much higher profits. These are yields, right? These guys don't know enough about how to price inputs. These are yields, but with profits, it's even more sensitive, getting fertilizer right. Okay, and there are big differences across states in yield growth associated with different soil and water conditions. Okay, so first, the great National Council of Applied Economic Research Additional Rural Income Survey, this is another feature of India that's just great, said, okay, we have this green revolution, let's do a survey, a rural survey, which is gonna actually oversample the areas where these new high-yielding varieties are predicted to do well, and let's follow these farmers in the first 3 years of this new technology. Right? So, wow, this is exactly what we want to have. And if you look into the third year of the round, start 68, 69, 70, 71, as to the probability, say, of whoever adopted these new high-yielding varieties in areas in which somebody had. So we've eliminated those areas where it, you know, nobody would ever use wheat in a certain area, or rice or corn, the new high-yielding varieties. You can see that primary school farmers were significantly more likely to adopt the new high-yielding varieties. Okay. Not secondary, it was primary. And the other things are usual, you know, big landowners. Well, remember, the model said, bigger the scale, bigger the return to new technology. Other reasons as well, credit constraints, of course. Okay. So the question is, you know, why is this true? It could be that they have higher incomes, it could be they're just you know, privileged in some way, they have contacts with government, so we went a little bit more. So what Andrew Foster and I did was to use the panel from 71 to 82 to actually estimate a profit function with parameters that were changed by the new technologies differentially across districts of India, and to see to what extent the returns from those changes in the technologies were higher for the more skilled farmers, taking into account that adoption is endogenous, et cetera. And this is a basic summary of what we found. So the way to summarize is to take three states characterized as we estimated by differential growth in yields associated purely with technical change, meaning the suitability of the soil. Okay, so Punjab, right? The breadbasket, really suitable for these high-yielding wheat varieties. And what we found there, where there was this much higher rate of technical change and productivity and much more at stake, the primary school farmers had profits that were 40% higher than illiterate farmers, right? A big return in this high technology state. Karnataka was average, the difference was 17%. Kerala, which is, as you know, a highly educated state, but wasn't really, it didn't really benefit as much from the initial green revolution and the high yielding varieties. The rate of return is the differential profit effect is 10%. Okay, so the returns to schooling really did depend on the context. Okay, so this is the table that I refer to that I really like. So now we're going to go back to the first 3 years. So we look at these farmers, we look at 3 years of use of HYV, high yielding varieties, and the profitability of use of these high yielding varieties. Okay. And these are estimates, panel estimates with farmer fixed effects, instrumenting for the use of HYV to look at the effects of using the new technology on profits. So just like we looked at the effect of using the pill and IUD on actual birth outcomes, here we have the results from using these technologies. So in the first column, the first thing to see is that if you were not educated and had never used HYVs, on average, your profits were lower. Okay? So that's telling you right away that this is not an easy technology. Okay? If you didn't have any schooling and you didn't know, you've never seen this thing before, on average, farmers were taking losses. Right? This is, in a sense, testimony to the bravery of farmers in India, right? Because despite that, right, they continue to. Okay, so the next thing we see is interactions, whoops, between the current HYV use, right, and the prior use of HYV in the second period, we've got 3 years, okay? And this is telling us that for every hectare, I think, of use of HYV, there's an increase in the current return from using the current HYV. In other words, the more you've used this before, the higher the return to HYV. That's evidence of learning. And in addition, when you go to the third year, the contribution of having that marginal increase in past experience goes down by a lot. It's one fifth, approximately, of what the effect was of having the first year of experience. Okay, so just as the model, the Bayesian learning model, predicted, there's a return to experience in terms of profitability, and that return is diminishing over time. Right, just as the model said. Fine. Okay, the model also tells us that those farmers that had primary schooling compared to illiterate farmers, which is the basic cutoff back then, right, were getting a much higher return. So that's consistent with what we saw, which is the primary school farmers were the ones to first adopt it, right? They were getting more profitability. But now we get to the crux of the matter. Is this because they had superior information at the start, superior access, or was it a learning effect? And the answer is clear in the second column. When we interact schooling, using HYV, amount of use, and experience. Okay? And what that tells us is that the current profitability of using the new technology the effect of experience on the profitability of using the current technology is higher for primary school farmers than non-primary school farmers. The primary school farmers were getting more profitability from the same experience compared to the unschooled farmers, i.e., schooling was contributing to learning. So this is telling us everything that model wanted to know about what the role of schooling is in learning in this complicated technology. Now, I found one other example, historical, that my new friend Jim Besson of Boston University is working on. So this is new workers in New England in the United States, where he got information on the yards per hour that these workers were associated. These are power looms, new technologies for the day. But even if they weren't new, when you hire a worker who's never used them, right, he can track over time how many yards per hour was being produced by that worker. I mean, the worker is basically watching this machine and making sure it's fully operational and fixing it as quickly as possible when it gets mucked up, right? And they're learning, you know, how to do that fast, how to spot trouble right away. And you can see that there's a wonderful Bayesian learning curve, right? There's learning over time, then real productivity, and it's diminishing. So there's learning, and there's loom workers right now in India, right? So presumably this is relevant to them. What he hasn't done, and I'm trying to convince him to do, is to tell us how these patterns differ by the literate and illiterate workers, right? That we'd like to see, you know, that as well. Okay. So that's learning. What about learning from others? Well, the same study where we had these 3 years, we did a very simple thing, which is to look at whether the experience of farmers that were close by, in this case in the same village, to our sample farmers, was paying off for the sample farmers. That is, whether they were learning from the experience of others in the village, right? So instead of just having N, the cumulative experience for that own farmer, the learning by doing part, we had the N for the farmers in the village. And the question was whether the experience of other farmers in the village was also contributing to the profitability of this own response. And the basic results were that, yes, it did. The trajectory of the effects of neighbor's farmer experience on this farmer's return profitability just had the same shape as the model would suggest. In addition, now that there are spillovers, right, then we did some more interesting economics. Okay, well, if there are these learning spillovers, we would expect that farmers would take this into account. There can be free riding, there can be benefits from depending on who you're with. So we did some simulations from our structural estimates of these models. Okay? So this is on the right-hand side, on the x-axis, we have the number of years of use of the HYV, starting from first use. And on the y-axis, we have profits per hectare. Okay. And the straight line, the discontinuous straight line, is what happens to traditional yields over time. And guess what? They don't change over time, right? There's nothing to learn. They've been using these for years. That's the definition of a traditional. So that's that line, okay? And the other lines are under different regimes. And the one I'll just talk about is when farmers are optimally planting. Okay? Now, optimal in this case is interesting because since you learn more by planting more, right, you get a return from overplanting if you were just looking myopically at your current profits. So if you're worried about taking losses, you're not going to plant very much. If you're forward-looking and can benefit from that, you're going to plant a little more, right? Because the more you've planted, the more you've learned, and the faster you're going to get profitability. Okay? So the... Whoa. So close together. So this continuous line is optimal planting when there's spillovers. Okay? So you're not only learning from your own experience, you're learning from your neighbors. And you can see compared to the case in which there are no spillovers, which is this case, okay, you're reaching the break-even point compared to using traditional varieties 1 year earlier compared to the case where there's no spillovers. So the spillovers are not trivial. Now you'd like to know, so those are the effects on profits, right? Which is what matters. What about adoption rates? So this is now simulated from the model, the proportion of land allocated to the new varieties, right? Which is, that's the right button, increasing over time. You get the nice S shape that everyone talks about with technology. And again, so this is a more interesting experiment. So one of the predictions of the model that I mentioned is that farmers with larger landholdings, okay, have a larger scale of operation, and then for two reasons, they're going to adopt faster. One is they get higher returns. The other might be because of credit constraints. Okay? So if you have a small farmer next to a large farmer, that small farmer is next to a farmer that's planting a lot of HYV. And if there's spillovers, that small farmer is going to benefit from it. We can turn that around, right? If a big farmer is next to a small farmer, he's getting very little benefits, right? Because the small farmers are not actually using the HYV very much. So the best case is when you have a poor person with rich neighbors, right? And that's this. Okay? But basically what the graph is showing is that the distribution of land is going to matter for adoption rates. Right? Who is next to whom is going to matter. And the spillovers are non-trivial in terms of how fast people are using the new technology. Now, this is not the only study on learning spillovers. Kyle and Munchie has a nice article, which is basically again, looking at these technologies and noting that rice technology is less transferable than wheat technology, and that's going to have implications for how fast people learn and whether they can learn from others. To the extent that your experience with rice is not really very relevant to mine, there should be less spillovers. To the extent that your planting of wheat, however, has a lot of externalities in principle, we should see different effects of learning by doing for the two technologies. He finds that very nicely. So it's good evidence, again, that there's learning by doing. This is using basically the same data from the ARIS study of the rice farmers, but in a very different way. Okay? More recently, we have our randomized experiments, okay, with new technologies. There's a few of those. So we have Bandura and Razul, who are doing a randomized introduction of sunflower seeds, new technology for these farmers. And he finds, again, faster adoption. Who took them up? More schools. Okay. He also finds evidence, they find evidence, of learning by doing, because he finds, actually, one other implication of learning by doing, strategic behavior. He finds that if in the group, you're in a group where someone else had adopted the technology, you're actually more likely to adopt it, right? You get these learning scores. Okay, sorry, the other way around. So basically, if someone in your group was offered the new technologies, you sit back and watch what happens, or you hold back, and he finds the strategic behavior that's implied by learning scores. Passing to Tom,
bed net adoption.
Again, she finds this new technology for them, more educated, we're more likely to adopt the bed nets. And she infers there's also learning because, again, a subject was more likely to adopt the bed net if someone in the group had been given the subsidized price. Okay, and that's despite the fact that there should be negative externalities. That is to say, if someone else in your group is protected from the bed net, you're less likely to get the disease. That should make you use the bed net less, right? So it actually dominated that health externality. Oster and Thornton, menstrual cup adoption. This one is from students, so there's no education effect. But again, there was good evidence that there were peer effects. So if someone in your peer group had been offered the cup, you were more likely to take it up. And they can show that, in fact, that was because, not because of peer pressure or anything else, but actually because they were better able to use it. They learned faster. So that was an example of learning externalities. Okay? Then we have Conley and Udry looking at learning externalities in the context of 46 farmers in Kenya, and he finds that is the case. But while it's fertilizer adoption, there's really no new technology, and he doesn't find any schooling effects. Okay, so there's clearly a role for schooling and learning. There's lots of evidence, both RCTs and other clever use of characteristics of technologies and panel data to show that there's learning from others as well. So there is a solid microeconomic foundation, microeconometric foundation for these ideas embedded in the growth models. Now, one course issue that actually has not been addressed in any of the literature directly is, of course, whether any of these schooling effects are just basically telling us that people who had more schooling when the new technologies came in just happened to be more able, right? That schooling is just a reflection of ability, and the schooling part is just a signal for us as econometricians that these are more able. Okay? No one has worked with this econometrically directly, but there's indirect evidence. If you believe that the population sort of understands what's going on, and this indirect evidence is that when the returns that we measure to schooling go up, like in the Green Revolution case, there's a significant response in terms of schooling investment. Okay. So they could be fooled too. They could not figure out that maybe it was just the smart people who were able to do this better. But since these guys know everybody, right, presumably they can figure out the difficult identification that is needed here, that it's really schooling. So for the Indian Green Revolution, we showed that, in fact, using our estimates of where a technological change was most rapid and most profitable, that precisely it was in those areas that school enrollment increased. Well, that could have been happening anyway,
But more interestingly, it increased for households that own land, that is for farm households, but not for landless households. That's consistent with the model. Why? Because farm households are making managerial decisions, input decisions about fertilizer, for which we have this evidence that schooling plays a role, while landless households are basically manual laborers taking orders from farm managers. There's no scope for schooling to help their productivity. They are like the Philippine harvest workers. Their schooling payoffs are basically nil to the extent that they stay in those occupations. Second piece of evidence, again from India, Kaivan Munshi and I looked at a very interesting phenomenon in Mumbai. This now relates to an earlier study that we saw, which is that in Mumbai, this is the graph of school enrollment and crop productivity from the Indian Green Revolution over the period 71-82. Okay. So this is what we saw in Mumbai. Okay. If you run a Mincer earnings equation, in the period of the 1980s, the four reforms took place in India, and in the 1990s. Okay. And the aqua bar is the estimated rate of return to years of schooling, about 10%. And you can see from this that there was no change in the rate of return to school. But you can also see something else, this is for males, that there was a substantial increase after the reforms, which presumably opened up the economy to trade and commerce, for which Mumbai had always been a player, and an increase in the rate of return to schooling from about 17% to 23% for men, and for women, an enormous difference. For the few women that were working, there's some selectivity. Right, over time. Okay. So now the question, so we have this big change in returns. This is not econometrically sophisticated, but we understand why this might have happened in the reform period, right? It makes sense that this would occur. And what we see in the data, we look at female students, we see a concomitant rise from enrollments in English language schools. So we start in the early 80s, before the reforms, and it's very caste-related. The upper castes were dominant, 30% of the upper castes were in the expensive private English medium schools. Only 10% of the women in the lower castes were in English medium schools. And after the reforms, we go from 30% to almost 60% of the high caste women, and from 10% to 35%, 3.5 times, right? Increase. These are not subtle changes, responding presumably to the changes in rates of return. And if you look at boys, it's equally impressive in terms of the overall rises in enrollments, right? So people were moving, even in the lower castes, from free private local language schools to expensive English medium schools. No school changes here either. There were no schools built during the period. Less convergent for boys. We have a nice model and story to explain why the differentiation is between boys and girls. Though there's, I think, another story as well that's associated with caste. But the point is a large response. Okay, that they were responding to the returns. A recent study by Oster and Millett looked at the local effects of the initiation of call centers, English language call centers, outside the main cities, using a nice diff and diff analysis. And they showed that there was a 15% increase in enrollments in English medium schools local around those areas where these things had taken place. Okay. And these effects of responses to demand side changes associated with growth and policy changes are really substantially larger than the supply side stuff that we see in the literature. That's sort of more popular, less popular now. So two that I like to use, because they're enormously expensive and enormously ambitious, are the Mexico Progressive Program, which was a conditional cash transfer program that's now sort of universal, praised all over the world, but actually thought of as a complete failure by the person who was president of Mexico when it was initiated. The effect of this on schooling was 0.66 years, as computed. Right, with about 10%. The largest school building program in the history of the world in Indonesia, where the government decided to use the wealth that they have accumulated from the oil price boom for schooling, nice intentions. So they increased the amount of school availability. All these economists are telling them it's all school availability, right? That's the reason that schooling is so low in Indonesia. That increased schooling by 0.31 years. So, and the estimated return to this, when you took into account the selectivity of wage workers with non-wage workers, 3.2%. Okay? So this is an example of pushing schooling in a context in which there's nothing else going on, where schooling would obviously have a particular contribution to make to growth or productivity. And the assessment of the Progressive Program, the wonderful, well-managed program for transferring resources to the poor, but it's not a development program. It's been totally unsuccessful in spurring any kind of growth. All right, so there's, I would argue, there's substantial, rigorous microeconometric evidence on the mechanisms of these endogenous growth models, or at least the Romer type, where we see learning externalities, but we only see them just as Romer's model suggests when there's new ideas flowing in. That otherwise, the schooling, it's sort of dormant, right? It sits there, but doesn't play a role, independent of that there being new ideas, new technologies, new productivity-enhancing things coming into the economy. All right, so what about Lucas's idea on increasing returns to human capital? So, as we all know, right, if you pick up any data set and regress the school enrollment or school attainment of kids on the schooling of parents, you get a positive correlation, right? So if we were unsophisticated, we'd say, there's Lucas, right? The higher the schooling of kids, the more investment there is in the next generation, right? But we know that's not right, right? That correlation could exist for lots of reasons. Genetic correlations in ability, common cultural family notions that people should be schooled even if there's no return, right? So we need to do a better job. And in fact, there's a whole slew of studies using newer techniques in the last 5 years or so to get at this in a superior way. And if you look at the current issue of the Journal of Economic Literature, there is a review of those studies. And the studies are of three methodologies. One is twins. Right? You have identical twin mothers, right? And you look at who have different schooling, and you look at the effect on the schooling of their kids. So you've sort of broken most of the genetic correlations. The second set are adoptions. So you have parents adopting a kid. There's no genetic correlation between their ability and the kids on average. And the third sets of estimates were IB. So they look at all these things and take into account what biases there might still be. And their summary is that the fine, which is the effect of the level of schooling on schooling investment, is 0.1. Of course, schooling attainment doesn't matter. It's 0.1. As they say, it's very small. Okay? The effect, and it's much smaller in the cross-section. And unlike what you normally find in the cross-section, this is true for all these studies, the role for women's schooling is no different than the role for father schooling. Okay? What most of the methods do is ramp down the schooling of the mothers to make it more equal to the fathers. But in any case, it's small. How relevant is this to India or low-income economies? Well, the problem is that all the studies, twins, adoptions, and IB, are from the United States, France, England, and Scandinavia. Okay? And these are economies where there's essentially a negative relationship between mother schooling and the amount of time they spend with children. They're working. Secondly, these are economies where actually parents aren't doing very much with parenting. There's daycare centers, preschool, right? There's a lot of programs that are available in these countries, particularly the Scandinavian countries, where the most reliable evidence are coming from. So it may actually not be very relevant. Like all reduced form interventions, the coefficients you get are very context specific. And in this case, we could think that this may really give us a lower bound estimate, which is not very interesting when the lower bound is awfully low. Right? When someone says the lower bound estimate is zero, that's not very informative. We know that in advance. It's not negative. Yes? 10 minutes. Great. We're good. Okay, what about low-income countries? There actually has not been any of these methods used for low-income countries.
The only thing we have is this article by Berman et al. On one of the animals, okay, published in the JPE. Lucas was the editor. So you can see he liked this, because we actually found circumstantial evidence. I'll still tell you what it is, right? Because there's no trick here. Circumstantial evidence that the schooling of mothers really mattered for the schooling of children. And it's behavioral. It's not basically estimating this production, okay? And it basically exploited the Green Revolution again. We used a model that incorporated that schooling for women could increase the bargaining power. That it incorporated the Lucas relationship, that schooling is productive in producing human capital, and it incorporated marriage market selection. Okay. Rural India in the 70s and 80s, what do we see? Okay. So first of all, unlike in Solaris, they're just richer than they were, as I'll show you before. But they're, you know, the caste system is alive and well, marriages are traditional, there's still dowry, and women's traditional role in agriculture is the same as it ever was. Okay? There's a lot more enterprises outside the farm, but nothing much substantial change. Anyway, so we have this, at least in the initial years, in the 70s and 80s. Okay, but what you also saw was that in those areas with high technical change, you see, we're really leveraging our estimates of these technical change estimates. The demand for literate wives went up significantly. So for the same schooling of husbands, you could see the marriage rates for more literate wives. You could see the dowry for literacy. This relation between the literacy of who you marry and the dowry paid was strongly negative, okay, as a function of the Green Revolution. Okay. And within households where we had lots of extended households, two or more mothers with different schooling, married to brothers in the household, the kids with the more literate mother compared to the other, household fixed effects, were spending more time in homework. So there's some direct correlational evidence for this. Okay. So however you looked at this data, it was pretty clear that the story was returns to schooling went up for farmers. Farmers are boys. We saw that there's more schooling investment in boys as a consequence. But because they also knew that schooling would be more efficacious with a mother who was more schooled, the demand for more school mothers went up, in this case, literate mothers. Okay? So all telling us, possibly, that the Lucas relationship was alive and well. Okay, health. We've got 7 minutes left. Right? We're supposed to talk about health in school. So now we're going to talk about health. Okay. So there's now pervasive evidence for lots of different interventions that improving health can raise productivity and incomes where these are low. So I'll give two recent examples because they give us the most outrageously high effects. Okay. I don't believe them for a minute, but that's okay. So first we have the deworming result where school-age kids were subject to a deworming experiment for, I think, 2 years, which stopped. Then they looked 10 years later or so, and those who had been treated, attempt to treat, had 25% higher wages. The 25% that were doing wages. Okay? Quite bleakly, looks at malaria eradication in the Americas over a time series, and he finds that compared to being infected with malaria, eliminating that malaria for your entire life would result in your earnings being 50% higher. Right? So these are the highest magnitude effects that you could ever see. He actually didn't have wage rate data, but that's another story. Let's just take that. Okay. The key point is that unlike the mechanism highlighted in growth models, the returns to health investments have diminishing returns. Now you saw that learning had diminishing returns, but that was for a given technology. The secret of the Green Revolution is it wasn't one-shot HYV. It was a continual flow of new technologies. Every year, the farmer has to make decisions about whether to adopt the newest technology or not, and how to use that new technology. Learning was continuous. Schooling, then, is a persistent effect in facilitating the productivity of these new technologies. There is nothing about health
that overcomes the diminishing returns to health. And what do I mean by this diminishing returns? All right. So the first credible estimates of the effects of nutrition on productivity was done by John Strauss. And he was the first one to first overcome this problem that you only observe earnings, you know, for wage workers by going in and collecting data in Sierra Leone on farm profits, okay, noting that calorie consumption was a choice variable. So you couldn't just look at the correlation between profits and calories and say, oh, it's positive, therefore calories impact on profits. So he used the IV procedure to do that. And the key thing he found is the quadratic relationship at best. And that's right from the article. And that's what he found. That's the diminishing returns. We all know this, right? If you add calories to people who are starving, it's going to have a big impact on productivity. As the average calorie level goes up, you know, if we all have another biscuit on average per day, it's just not going to increase our productivity at all. Okay? So that's a feature of the health interventions, right? If people really don't have malaria, then spraying DDT is not going to have any effect, right? Okay. So here's a graph that illustrates the point. This is India and the Green Revolution. So Bala and Das have put together from various sources the growth in real wages, that's the green line, in India. Rural India, okay? And you can see, you know, two and a half times increase over the period 70 to 2004. So that's an example of real growth, right? Great, okay? So I've overlaid on this, what would happen if there were no Green Revolution, but we actually, but there was malaria or worms in India, and we use these max estimates from these guys' studies, okay, and overlay that here. So, this is the middle of the period. So the red line is what would happen if, you know, people had worms in India and we did the deworming intervention, got rid of worms. This is what the wage trajectory would have looked like, okay, compared to this. Okay? So it's not sustained growth, it's just a one-shot thing. And this is the one if everyone were malaria in India, right? Of course, that's not the case even if we were looking. So it's really not going to be that big. Okay? So that's the distinction between an effect on growth rates and having a one-shot effect, which is what health does. That's one part of what it does. One other example from Bangladesh. Bangladesh had one of the most successful public health interventions in the history of the world. They were rife with diarrheal disease and dysentery. And as a function of collaboration between the government and on NGOs, they basically reduced morbidity by cleaning up the water supply over the period. And this graph is over the 1981 to 2002 period, shows the fraction of the rural population in Bangladesh over that period that had clean water sources, okay, as a function of, due to this public health intervention. And in survey data, from surveys that I participated in rural Bangladesh, starting in 81-82, which was a random sample meant to be representative of the entire population of Bangladesh, compared to 2002 for the same villages, you see that over this period, there was an increase in BMI over that 20-year period for males and for females at every age, and an increase in stature. Okay? So these public health interventions really did improve the health of the population with, okay, now, so here, and also during this period, there was not only an increase in school enrollments or attendance, this is the 1981-82 period by age, attendance in school. You can see starting at age 8, at every age, boys were going to school more than girls. Okay, and say, let's say at age 11, about 45% of boys and 35% of girls went to school. You look 20 years later, and it's almost 90% of girls in that age are in school, and 85% of boys at every age, girls are going to school more than boys. Right? So you had this marvelous human capital revolution and growth, right? Great story. But here's the punchline from this. The top line
There's real wages in rural Bangladesh. No growth at all. So all this human capital investment, which is great, improved the lives of these people enormously through interventions and other reasons, right? Nothing to do with growth. So neither the rise in schooling is an income effect, nor is there, you know, those are general equilibrium things, so you can't, you know, the counterfactual you can't quite pin down. But basically, this is not a story of agricultural productivity improvements over the period, despite these interventions. Okay, so that's some evidence on health and growth. So far, there isn't any, right? But there's another fact, there's another role that health can play, which is the endolucus production function. Okay? And there's a lot of studies looking at this, which is the basic idea that nutrition and learning are complementary. That is, in particular, well-fed children learn more at school. And we actually have a lot of interventions testing just that. RCT interventions. There's a whole slew of them. Deworming, early childhood nutritional supplementation, iodine supplementation, vitamin A supplementation, right? For kids. And then looking at either school attendance or school attainment, some of the ones that are longer running, even wage rates. Okay? Common finding. These nutritional interventions at an early age show up in increased schooling for girls. And sometimes test scores for girls, right? So presumably they get more schooling as they're learning more from school. In many cases, there's no effect on boys. This is common in these. So one question is, why are these weak effects and effects that differ by gender? Weak effects for boys and effects that differ by gender. Well, they're not estimating the production function. It's a reduced form intervention, a policy response, right? And there are two things that happen when you increase people's nutritional intake. One, you increase their ability to learn in school, presumably. And the fact that schooling went up for girls suggests that that's probably true. But you also increase their productivity outside of school. Remember the harvest workers, the taller ones, were more productive. Well, basically, these nutritional interventions are increasing the body mass of everybody. What about the male-female difference? Well, it turns out that nutritional interventions increase the strength of boys that have no effect on the strength of girls, biological model for that, and biological evidence, as well as econometric evidence for that. So basically, it's increasing the opportunity cost of schooling for boys relative to girls. Right? And that opportunity cost in effect on schooling can totally wipe out the complementarity effect. In fact, in Blakely's study of malaria eradication, while he finds this enormous increase in wages, he finds absolutely no effect on schooling. So none of it was through human capital accumulation. And we can look, how much time do I have left?
None.
Okay, fine.
On the 50 minutes, you're already at 50 seconds.
Okay, I didn't see your 5-minute warning, so that's not your fault, it's my fault. So let me do two things then in my negative time. One is to show you some additional results that verify this idea that schooling doesn't always have a payoff and relate that to growth, and then just summarize a few thoughts I had about an agenda that's growth-oriented for human capital. Okay. So I was going to talk about, if I had time, another way to look at labor markets and schooling that incorporates both health and schooling and skill. And that's ROI models, where workers are bundles of human capital and skill and bundles of brawn or strength, right? And in those models, the wage of a worker is basically determined by the productivity of those attributes of the worker across different firms, and the returns to the two attributes differ by activities. Okay? And without going into the details of the forthcoming article, basically these estimates are showing that the contribution of schooling to wages is zero for 67% of the activities, occupations of people in rural Bangladesh. It's only positive in particular activities, all of which corresponds to what you would think, rickshaw pullers, zero return to education, etc. The positive return to schooling for most of the activities that women are in. Why are they in those activities? Because they're sorting according to comparative advantage. So I won't talk about this. Let me talk about, well, this is what, quickly, this is what's happened to the skill intensity of occupations in China, period, since the reforms in the early 80s, growth and skill intensity. This is what's happened to the rate of return to schooling for men and women. It's gone up over that period, right? This could not possibly be explained by what I didn't get a chance to talk about, by Mincer earnings functions, okay? And what you see is that it's the skill intensity of the occupations that women are going into is rising faster than that of men, which corresponds to the fact that it looks like their returns are higher. And that's because they tend to be in more skill-intensive occupations where schooling has a higher payoff compared to men. All right, let me summarize. Okay, so now I'll get a little more controversial. Okay. So what does this suggest about a research agenda that actually is growth-oriented? For which I love all these studies that I saw. I didn't see that many that really related to growth. Okay. So first is, I worry that there's too much poor economics. What do I mean by that? I don't mean the economics is bad. I mean that people are studying populations that are not experiencing any growth or change or development. And it's elementary social science that you're not going to learn about how to escape poverty by selectively looking at people who haven't. You need to look at settings in which there is success. So looking at places where people are poor and there's garbage in the streets is missing the point. The point is, you know, how come there are no slums in Manhattan and there's slums in Mumbai? Right? It isn't because of government officials, right? It may be because of bigger things like that. All right, so that's my first point. The second is, it comes directly from this evidence, that schooling has payoffs when there's new ideas, innovations, technologies. So one can frame a development question as, what's preventing the flow of new technologies, innovation, et cetera, into a setting? Right? It's not a human capital agenda, that's a more fundamental agenda of thinking about why the returns are low in terms of there's nothing for schooling to help us with. Third, what kind of schooling is actually more relevant? Okay. We can think of the stage of development after agricultural development is industrialization. People, the ag wage workers, now working in factories. Okay. What kind of schooling is relevant to that kind of work? And that gets into the cognitive versus non-cognitive, which there's very little in developed low-income country work on non-cognitive skills. Most of the evidence is showing that in developed countries, cognitive test scores have little to do with wages, controlling for schooling. Non-cognitive test scores do. Does learning the names of capital cities of Middle East countries make for a better factory worker? I doubt it. Does algebra? I doubt it. Right? Excessive focus on cognitive test scores may be inappropriate depending on the level of development. We don't have any evidence of this, but it's part of what one could do. Similarly, work and health interventions do the most good in terms of contributing to growth. Okay. And then finally, I mean, one could automatically make any studies of human capital relevant to growth by redefining what growth is. And I tend to favor that. I think Bangladesh has, in a very real sense, in rural areas, experienced growth. The people are more educated, and they're healthier, and they're bigger, right? They've had no income growth, but in some real sense, they've grown. So one could think of this less strict definition of growth, of sort of per capita income changes, to incorporate schooling. It widens the agenda quite a bit. Let me stop there.
That's a remarkable tour de force. I'm delighted that we're all here to listen to Mark's enormous wealth of knowledge. Floor is open. We've got no time. We've got three questions at most as we can take. And yeah, the lady over there, and the gentleman there, and the gentleman there. I'm afraid that's it. Yeah.
So there's a huge difference in start thinking about context of the green economy concept being adopted for 17th for United Nations conference, Rio Plus 20, 2012?
The results of the effect of education on adoption, the rates of adoption. So the mechanism, is it reflecting just the fact that attitudes change, or education is a form of insurance that people are willing to take more chances because they know they can, or is it that they just pick up stuff faster, that they understand the new technology faster? I mean, is it going through just a better way of evaluating technologies, or is it?
Let me answer one at a time. Well, all the other things that you raised could also be true. We have what I regard as strong evidence that one component of that is that more school people do learn faster. And we see it directly, we see it in terms of profitability. This is not about attitudes or anything else. It shows up in a faster rise of profits as they gain experience in using the new technologies. And so we have supportive evidence for that mechanism underlying why we see the more educated farmers adopt. This doesn't mean there's not scope for additional research to look at other avenues. And that would be great too. And it would be great because it's, in my view, in the context of trying to understand the process of technology adoption and growth. So absolutely.
Okay, since the organizers themselves want to ask questions, I'm obviously going to tell Alan. For Suman, and then the lady here, and then Prince Mukherjee.
Mark,
I mean,
there was this graph there on the HYB about the big gap between traditional and new technologies in the early years, okay, which must contain a lot of information or raises a lot of issues about risk, the capacity to handle risk, absorb. So what are some of the kind of complementary policies that might be needed in this process?
So, that when you have new technologies, you're basically increasing the risk. There are farmers, and that's one of the reasons why the larger farmers are adopting first. They can handle risk better because they basically have the savings and the access to credit that smaller farmers don't. So that's one of the important things. So let me give a hint as to what I might say later about the plan. Okay? That scale solves all these problems. If farmers were larger scale, a lot of these problems of access to credit and having to absorb risk at very low incomes get reduced because they are larger and for obvious reasons. Farming in India is too darn small. And so all of these problems that we're trying to solve with expensive interventions and subsidies are fundamentally caused by the fact that it's too expensive to give lots of little loans to farmers, that it's too expensive to monitor lots of different farmers, that it's too expensive to administer index insurance or any other kind of insurance. Larger scale solves those things for us, and we have evidence, some of you have seen that Andrew presented at the other conference, that bigger farmers, for all those reasons and more ability to adopt mechanization, are much significantly more profitable than smaller farmers. So my policy is more fundamental, right? The fundamental one is, why are farms so small in India? And I think the answer is industrialization is lacking. There's no place for rural people to go. If we can find good jobs for rural people, they will leave what is one of the worst occupations in the world, which is agriculture, to get a good factory job or a job in Walmart, just to take a random example, a policy relevant thing, right? And when they leave, leaves more scope for farms to get bigger. My prediction is that agriculture will become more productive, more dynamic, more mechanized, and there'll be more output from agriculture as a consequence of industrialization. That it's a win-win policy to industrialize India. So that's my answer to that.
And therefore, the farm side productivity debate is somewhat poorly specified, would be an implication.
Two things. One, yes, but another thing that's changed is within India, the possibilities of mechanization. I mean, Indian firms are selling the implements that are useful in India. And so only recently, I mean, in the last 5 to 7 years do we actually see a big gradient between mechanization and farm size that never existed before. So in part, the old studies are not relevant to today's opportunities. And in part, they didn't get some of the things right.
In your discussions of health, change anything else you said.
Right. So there's two ways in which lifespans increase. One is reducing infant mortality. That has zero effect on this. The other is increasing it at the other end. Okay. With discount rates, you know, extending people's life, if that's only is what happened, you know, most of these things are correlated with other good things, but if it's strictly that we increase life expectancy from 70 to 75 or 65 to 75, its impact on the returns to schooling is minimal. Okay? But I don't think that's what goes on when we see life expectancy. It's sort of a catch-all for these real improvements in morbidity and everything else.
Mark, you're measuring growth by looking at agricultural wages, and I'm just wondering whether you're not aren't you missing at least three other important effects conceivably of human capital programs. One is migration, which you just mentioned. You know, people need to leave the farms, and education as a determinant of whether or not people migrate. Second, improvement in governance. So more literate people, you know, voting in a different way and so on. And getting governments to be more accountable. Third, drop in fertility. So mother's education related to all of that. So all of that is not going to be picked up in agricultural wages.
Feedback loops.
Okay. So you can show the same thing for, well, or agricultural profits or those sorts of things. So I actually meant to put on the slides those three things that people could begin to study. And I'm most enthusiastic about the migration part. But India, once again, as a manifestation of the lack of industrialization, is lagging behind all other countries with the same growth rate in terms of migration. It's one of the lowest mobile countries in the world. Schooling has gone up enormously, in fact, in India, without any substantial increase in mobility. So everywhere else when you look, there's a positive relationship between schooling and mobility. The school people actually have, when there are wage gaps, the highest return to leaving. It's not even necessarily just mechanical, that they will get more out of a given sort of real difference in skill prices than before. So I think that's a great one to study. And we need more migration studies, which require actually much superior data. What were the other two?
Governance
for sure. This issue about whether more educated leaders are better leaders, I would argue is actually an open question. I actually look for US presidents at the relationship between a number of ratings of the quality of US presidents, which you can get them from the Wall Street Journal, all different publications, liberal and conservative, and the ratings are pretty much consensus. And the relationship between the schooling of presidents and the ratings was basically zero. And this is not because, you know, when you go back in time, there was no schooling. The second president of the United States was a Harvard graduate. Okay, so, and most of the presidents were either West Point, or Ivy League graduates, or graduates of Amherst. I mean, so all these old schools go way back. But when you actually look at it's the Lincolns and the Washingtons and the Trumans that are in the top five, and they weren't schooled. Obama is very schooled. Jimmy Carter is very schooled. They even have high IQs. They're not going to rate very high in terms of leadership. So I think it's an open question, but it's a really good question to study, and the other one as well. So these are part, I think, very important parts of the growth agenda, because clearly I agree that leadership really matters, right, for making policy. And if education matters, one other point about education, 40% of the world's leaders of countries in 1990 were educated outside of their country. There's a whole issue about where people get their education and whether getting education outside the country is actually helpful in giving them a new vision of what a good economy looks like, because most of the places people get their schooling when they leave their country are OECD countries, arguably successful countries, and most of the students who go abroad are coming from very low income countries indeed. So those are great topics.
Sonia, very quickly, very briefly.
Between declines in child mortality and fertility.
Good. So I think both those points are valid. It's obviously an area that I skipped over. There hasn't been a lot of recent work on fertility. You know, in the 70s and 80s, population growth was seen as the biggest enemy of development. There was a lot of work, not very good, on the determinants of fertility and the consequences of fertility. So I think that's another great area where schooling and health could play a role. And it is true that Bangladesh, you know, it didn't show it. One of the other things that happened as part of the reductions in morbidity was fertility went down. One of the other factors in their success, though there was no growth.
I'm just going to make one very quick comment, actually. I particularly noted the sort of the last slide that Mark, you noted the fact that there's too much poor economics. In other words, you're not really, not enough studies of people, you're studying people who are moving out of poverty. Well, studying that actually requires having panel data. Unfortunately, we do not have a great tradition, at least in our country, of generating panel data. And I say this to you soon, because I think you're probably still a member of the Statistical Commission, that we really have to convince the NSS to try and generate and get more panel data as to who's moving out, who's moving in. It's just not enough to keep telling us every 5 years what's happening to employment, unemployment. It's just not enough. Thanks very much indeed, Mark.
So let's try and come back.